Where's my box? They don't have anything for me to stand on, or what the... I think you all hopefully know I'm General Chuck Krulak. I'm the Commandant of the Marine Corps. Let me start off by saying this guidance was issued on the 1st of July, 1995. It was called a Marine Corps for the 21st Century. On the first page, really the first sentence of the second paragraph right there, it talks about the two most important things that the Marine Corps does for the nation are to make Marines and to win battles. Winning battles translates into war fighting. And war fighting today is in a state of flux and a state of change. In the wake of the Cold War, the world as we know it is becoming enormously complex. I think you all see that just from what we've watched around the world and certainly even in the United States. Chaos is on the increase. The Marines, particularly those that are forward deployed, find the world a very dangerous place, requiring the most in training and certainly the most in demanding of our character. We've seen it before in places like Liberia, Somalia, and Bosnia, and we're going to see it again. Marines who patrol cities and towns experiencing the full spectrum of warfare just in three city blocks. I take you back to Somalia and the young Marine patrol leader who goes in the first block and is involved in humanitarian assistance, making sure food and water's passed out. They go the next block, and the next thing you know, they're keeping two warlords or tribes apart. And then the third block, they find themselves literally in some sort of mid-intensity conflict. If you think about that the Marine that operates in that unpredictable environment must be equipped with the finest weapons that America can provide, I think that's a given. But the Marine must also be equipped with the intellectual agility and the strength of character that allow him to withstand the environment and to be successful. From the youth of America come the Marines who will serve in this uncertain future. They hail from a modern society, one where fathers and mothers, schools and churches are working day and night to imbue in them character and ethics that this country has always been justifiably proud. Let me say from the onset, those mothers and fathers, the schools and the churches are doing a magnificent job. It's a struggle, though, and it's a struggle that the Marine Corps wants to join, just as we've joined other battles in support of this nation of ours. We want to take the same values that these young men and women have been given by their families and build upon them. We want to return to the mothers and fathers of America a son or daughter who is a better person because they chose to join the Marine Corps. As you will hear shortly, to make Marines and win battles in the future will be enhancing of our tried and true methods that we've had prior. We will improve on, we will intensify the process by which we transform today's young Americans into Marines. Marines forged in a furnace of tough and demanding challenges. The process that you're going to be briefed on today is a comprehensive effort, an effort beginning from the moment the young man or woman first meets the recruiter, continuing through recruit training and on to the unit itself, making Marines tougher physically, mentally, and morally, building cohesion and reinforcing values and principles, and then sustaining this literally throughout the Marine's career and beyond. Let me say again, this is not making things easier, this is making things tougher, physically, mentally, and morally. This approach is going to build upon our traditional core values of honor, courage, and commitment, and upon our combat-proven training methods. These are the vital touchstones for from which we will win what I call the battles of the future. In the end, however, making Marines not only translates into winning battles, which is the reason we exist as a Corps, it's also going to translate, in our opinion, into making the nation stronger. And we Marines take this as a sacred trust that's been given to us by the American people. With that as background, I'd like to ask my good friend, Colonel Keith Holcomb, Brigadier General Select, to come up and lay out this entire evolution. Keith, you got it.
Good afternoon. I am Colonel Keith Holcomb, and I'll spend about 15 minutes presenting this four-part process, comprehensive program, which the Commandant has just outlined and spoken to. I'd like to emphasize from the get-go that this is a program that's been developed in response to the operational demands that we expect to face on 21st century battlefields, and in response also to the challenges that modern society has provided to our youth. Now, if you'll turn to the chart that's to my left here, you'll see that it is indeed a four-phase process. It's a comprehensive program. It begins with the first contact that a recruiter makes with a potential recruit on the streets of America, and it continues through the recruit training process, through their assignment to a unit, and then for their life cycle as a Marine, whether that's the end of an enlistment or the end of a career. These blocks reflect for you about the percentage of effort that we see going into this new program in each one of those four areas. I'd also like to emphasize for you that what we have also done is build a bridge from one block to the other. So as you go through my brief, you'll see where we've built a bridge from actual recruiting into recruit training to make the transition easier and to better prepare the Marine for the recruit training that he'll receive. And you'll see that is also true as we assign them to units and then as we sustain them in the units. Next slide, please. The first block that I'm going to speak to is the enhancements that we've made with regard to recruiting. As we reviewed our program, we saw it was very effective. But there were two areas where we thought we could improve. The first area had to do with screening. We wanted to emphasize character more in the acquisition process. And so we've provided our recruiters a set of guidelines, if you will, that'll help them better see where there is strong character or where there is weak character in the potential recruits that they'll meet on the streets. And General Klimt could speak to that in greater detail later. The second area that we saw a need for improvement was in something we call our delayed entry pool program. That's where our recruits are waiting to be sent to either MCRD, Parris Island, or San Diego. In that program, we thought we could do a better job of preparing them for the training that they would be about to receive. And so some areas that we're intending to emphasize there are an introduction to total fitness, the Marines' total fitness concept as far as a mind, body, spirit, and morale, and also to prepare them for that training with physical conditioning, with introducing them to our core values, and with providing them with study guides on our traditions and our history. Next slide, please. The next area I'd like to turn to is the area that, as you saw in that first block, had about 40% of our effort, and that is recruit training. This is where we see what we're going to make a significant difference. As we looked at recruit training, we saw this was an area where we're turning out a good product now. But there were two areas there that we thought we could strengthen. The first is the idea of providing the drill instructor more time to work with the recruits to imbue them with a sense of our values and our standards. And the second, and we think most important, is the area of providing a crystallizing experience by which all that the recruit had learned in his previous 10 weeks of boot camp could be drawn together and brought sharply into focus. We're going to call this experience, this defining moment, the crucible. And as you'll see in the slides that follow, it is a very intense experience. It is tough. It is demanding. Next slide, please. I'll add that by adding the Crucible to boot camp, that we will actually be increasing boot camp by 1 week to a total of 12 weeks. Let's take a look at the Crucible. We intend to put it in the 11th week, and as you can see by the slide, it'll be 54 hours in length. There will be sleep and food deprivation. Now, I must add right up front that we've worked with doctors and nutritionists to make sure this is done in a safe and responsible manner. Nonetheless, we intend to add some stress to the boot camp experience, some additional stress, by depriving them of their sleep to some extent. They only get 4 hours per night, and by depriving them of some of the meals that they normally receive. What we've decided to do with the 54-hour training cycle is to have 8 major training events, which I'll go through for you in just a moment. And each one of these training events will be augmented by warrior stations, which will emphasize teamwork and our core values. Next slide, please. This next slide will show you a notional outline of that 54-hour period. As you can see, the recruits will be awakened at 2 o'clock in the morning. They'll immediately begin with a rigorous force march, and they'll go through 3 major day events. Each one of these day events are quite challenging mentally and physically, and these day events will be augmented by warrior stations, which I'll explain in just a moment. They'll then have an evening meal. They will then turn to a night event. One night will be a night movement. The second night will be a night infiltration. They'll have about 4 hours sleep. After 2 days of this, they'll then conduct a force march 9 miles in length to an amphitheater or a central assembly area where they'll receive 4 culminating events which bring into focus the training and the values that they've just undergone. Next slide, please. What I'm going to do is just give you an example of some of the events that the Marine recruits will be facing. Some of you, I know, are familiar with our reaction course. They're used by our officer candidates and also by our NCOs. Now we're going to be asking our recruits to go through these. When our leaders go through them, the leader is evaluated on how well he leads his team through the problem and on how well he solves a particular problem. As the recruits go through this, the emphasis will be on the team working together to develop a solution to the problem and to get through these challenging obstacles. And some of you are familiar with them. It's when you have a 20-foot creek and you only have 2 10-foot boards to cross it with, that sort of thing. The values that will be emphasized here are teamwork and confidence. Next slide, please. We'll have something called a casualty evacuation. It will involve carrying a Marine for about a mile over obstacles and very rigorous terrain. I bring this obstacle to your attention to emphasize that each one of the events will be named for a Marine hero. In this case, the obstacle is named for Lance Corporal Noonan, who won the Medal of Honor in Vietnam as he moved to rescue 4 of his fellow Marines who had been wounded on a steep hillside in Vietnam. He was killed in the process. The names of the obstacles will reflect the gender and ethnic makeup of our Marine Corps. Most of them are for Medal of Honor winners. Each of them will underscore a certain value which we want the recruits to take from that particular obstacle. Next slide, please. Our Marines receive pugil stick training. That's nothing new there. What's new here is that it'll involve our female Marines as well as our male Marines. I might add that our female officer candidates have been undergoing this training for about 3 years now, and so too will our enlisted starting with the first sequence that goes through this fall. Once again, the pugil stick events here emphasize team work because there's 2-on-2 as opposed to an individual's efforts. Next slide, please. As I mentioned earlier, we're going to have a night event each evening. The reason for the night events is, again, to add some stress with some sleep deprivation to the entire sequence. There's another reason that's even more fundamental. It's a bit subtle. And that is, for those of us who have been out on night ops, you're well familiar with the fact that you almost have to develop an intuitive sixth sense of where your buddies are and where they're not. And what we're stressing here is the whole idea of accountability as we go through a night event which will involve rigorous terrain and obstacles. Next slide, please. After 54 hours of this sort of experience, the Marine recruits will be brought back after a 9-mile force march to essentially the culminating events, which will involve a morning color ceremony, the awarding to the Marine recruit of his Marine emblem by his drill instructor, a message from the Commandant of the Marine Corps underscoring the value and the significance of what they've just accomplished, and lastly, a warrior breakfast. What's new about the idea of a warrior breakfast is that we intend to bring in Marines who have served before, that are heroes in our Corps, and have them sit down at breakfast with our recruits, our new Marines, and explain to them some of the challenges that they faced when they were on active service, some of the challenges they faced in combat, and to give that new Marine a sense of two things. One, someone else has gone through this kind of training before. Someone else has faced tough problems before. And the second thing is to give the Marine a sense of an extended family. I'd like to transition now to our third effort, something we're really quite excited about, and that is our unit cohesion program, which has been developed under the leadership and guidance of Brigadier General Select Greg Newbold. As you can see by this slide, we have a definition for unit cohesion. We look at it as an intense bonding that leads to an intuitive sense of who people are and what they're capable of in stressful situations. We have a quote here provided by William Manchester, which we think speaks to what true cohesion is. Next slide, please. What does our unit cohesion plan entail? Essentially, we intend to form teams early and keep Marines together as teams throughout that first enlistment, if at all possible. What's new about this? Well, as most of you know, we've been doing individual assignments, individual replacements for years. This is going to be a groundbreaking effort to do team or unit assignment. What this will entail is forming the team up, keeping the team together through their specialized skill training, and then assigning the team to their unit. We envision the teams that train together, deploy together, and fight together. Let me give you an example. Right now, there are 13 men in a Marine rifle squad. There's a squad leader and three fire team leaders, four NCOs. As we put this into effect, we would envision that we would take 9 new Marines out of the recruit depots and we would form them into a team, and that team would go through their School of Infantry experience together, a 4-week specialized skill training in infantry skills. That 9 men would go through that experience together, and at the end of the last week for the last major exercise, the squad leader and the three fire team leaders would come from the battalion that they were going to join, come down, participate with them in that last field exercise, and then take that newly formed squad back to the unit, and that squad would stay with the unit then for the duration of their enlistment. Next slide, please. Bottom line in all this is we see tremendous benefits accruing with regard to cohesion and increased fighting power. The last phase is sustaining the transformation. As you can see from the quote up there, we believe that things like shared privation, shared hazard, shared triumph build teams. What we want to do is sustain that experience throughout the Marines' enlistment. We see that we can sustain this by two methods. First of all, with our professional military education. Our NCOs, our staff NCOs, and our officers going to our professional schools will be exposed to our whole Marine character development program. And they will use this then as the basis when they return to the units as a way of assigning tasks in such a manner that team values, team cohesion is reinforced, and our core values are reinforced. Bottom line, we envision that this will increase our fighting power as well. The last point down there is we intend to hold the Marines accountable to the standards that we've set out for them, and we intend that our Marines will epitomize our three core values which have been spoken to. Last slide, please. We see from this initiative that two major legacies will accrue. First of all, there'll be a legacy to the Corps. We'll have Marines that are fully prepared to fight and win on the battlefields of the 21st century. More importantly, they will be worthy representatives of our nation's ideals while they're on those battlefields. The second major set of legacies that we see accruing is that the Marines that return to our civilian society after having served with the Corps, whether that be for 4 years or for 34 years, will be citizens who have been enriched by our ideals and our standards. Thank you very much. I'll be followed by General Klimp, who will act as moderator for your questions.
Ladies and gentlemen, as Keith said, I'm Major General Jack Klimp. I'm the Commanding General of the Marine Corps Recruiting Command. You've just seen the making of Marines for the 21st century. What we'd like to do now is offer you an opportunity to ask any questions you may have about the process.
Yes, sir.
General, what's the historical precedent? We know the Navy SEALs have something comparable to the Crucible called Hell Week. We know the British SAS have done this. Where else did you draw upon this for your ideas to put this together?
Sure, there are a number of areas. What I'd like to do is ask Brigadier Jerry Humble to come up here and ask that question. Jerry is the commanding general of the Marine Corps Recruit Depot at Parris Island. It was his people who put together the Crucible program for us. Jerry?
The ideas for the Crucible came, as you have already articulated, from some of our American forces, Ranger School, the SEALs training, but from the commando, British commandos, our fellow Marines with England. And I got to tell you that we've looked far and wide, sort of cast our nets wide, and found some things are being used in the civilian communities as well. And the whole purpose is to forge that teamwork together. Does that answer your question?
General,
yes,
the Corps and our other services already have trouble with meeting their recruiting quotas. You're going to do a tighter screen of these people. I understand that's already been underway in the field. How much problems do you think that's going to give you in meeting your quotas?
We don't think it's going to bother us at all, sir. In fact, as you said, it's already underway and has been underway for the better part of probably 2 years. We've been looking at our screening process and determining the way or ways in which we can tighten it up. I don't think, and we haven't seen any impact on it at all. In fact, we are doing much better recently than we have in the past. We're on the verge within, hopefully tomorrow, of accomplishing our assigned goals for the 12th consecutive month. We're probably at about 109, 112% of our mission right now. We don't see it as having an impact at all.
Yes, sir.
General, the incident on Okinawa or similar incidents, while the Okinawa incident apparently happened after this whole thing started, did it do anything to trigger this at all? Did it raise any red flags about possible problems with Marines and other young people in other branches of the armed forces?
Sure. No, sir. This wasn't triggered by any incident that's happened recently. In fact, as General Krulak said when he was up here, this whole program began as an analysis of what we view warfare being like as we move into the 21st century and what we needed to do to prepare those Marines. The analysis goes back as far as post-Desert Shield, Desert Storm, post-Restore Hope in Somalia. Yes, ma'am.
General, we've heard here about problems of sustainment. Are you having problems keeping Marines for their full time that they sign up for? If so, what have you seen? What is this reason for the team keeping someone in with the group that they know fiddling?
What I'd like to do is ask Colonel Greg Newbold, Brigadier General Select Greg Newbold, to come up here and answer that question. He's out of manpower up at the headquarters Marine Corps.
Your question related to are we losing more people in the process, and is that the cause for us to try to keep people together? Our statistics show we're losing about the same number as the other services, and we're trying to keep more of them around. And when we keep more of them around, we're trying to keep them around with the same sense of values that you heard articulated in the briefing. when we do that, we're trying to form very positive peer pressure rather than negative peer pressure, and a mentoring example of our small unit leaders that'll form this bond that you heard Colonel Keith Holcomb talking about.
Are you looking for people to re-up more often? What is the goal here? Just the 4 years or longer?
Well, I think you've answered all the parts of them. First of all, we're going to keep them in the Marine Corps through their contract to the extent that is possible. We're going to encourage Marines to reenlist, and therefore we'll have the greatest opportunity to keep the Marines that we want. And as also was mentioned in the briefing, we hope that when we return Marines to the community, they'll be the finest examples of citizens that we can.
I think in support of what Colonel Newbold said, I go back again to the purpose of the whole program, which was to address the battlefield of the 21st century. We certainly hope that a side effect of that will be a greater retention of Marines in the Corps, primarily through their first term of enlistment. As Greg said, our loss rate, our attrition rate, is about equivalent to the other services, and it is about today where it has been historically for the last number of years. Back to your question, sir, again, I think if we do this correctly, if we're even just a little bit successful, the impact upon our missions out there in recruiting should be positive. We should, in fact, have to recruit fewer people because we're able to retain more. Yes, sir.
General Krulak said that the nation's mothers and fathers and churches are doing a good job in preparing young people today, which is bureaucratic code word for they're not doing a good job. Is this an attempt to bring people up to a level that's more satisfactory to the Marine Corps because you're not getting the type of individuals walking through your doors with the character and the morale and the morals and the stature that you had hoped?
Well, I think the moms and dads of America have taken a bad rap. I think General Krulak said it very well, and I don't think there was any bureaucratic hidden meaning there. The moms and dads are working very hard. The churches and the schools are working very hard to instill in the youngsters of today the same moral values, character values that we were brought up with. The problem is there are a tremendous number of distractors out there, and you know them as well as I do. I think, again, I go back to we look at the battlefield that we anticipate that we're going to be on in the 21st century, the things that we're going to require of Marines, and we need to prepare those Marines for that battlefield. Let me give you an example. I was the commander of Task Force Mogadishu in Somalia during Operation Restore Hope. In probably early to mid-January, there was a lot of activity between the various clans over there. At one point, my command post was located in the stadium that was right on the green line between Adid and Mahdi's forces. We received a call at first light one morning that there was a Soviet tank, or a Soviet-style tank, outside one of our compounds and was training its gun barrel on the compound. We launched then-Captain Mike Campbell and two M1 tanks to go down and check it out. Mike got to the scene, and sure enough, there was a tank outside the compound that had not been there the previous day, and the tank was, in fact, training its gun on the walls of our compound. And in fact, as Mike pulled up, the tank's turret turned and the barrel was pointed right at Mike Campbell and his tanks. Mike, within the rules of engagement, had the right to open fire on that tank and to destroy it. He made a judgment call not to do that, held his fire, and after a couple of minutes, about six or seven youngsters, the ages of about 5 to 6, crawled out of this tank. What had happened is this tank had been was a derelict, had been hauled out of a compound that we were occupying, had been placed in front of this other compound without the people who were in there knowing about it. The children in the area crawled inside the tank. Soviet tanks of that model were all hand-manipulated. They weren't manipulated by hydraulics. It was a bunch of kids in there playing with a toy. Had he fired, he would have killed 6 or 7 children. Mike made the decision not to fire. That's the kind of battlefield that we're preparing our Marines for, and that's exactly why we're doing this program. Yes, ma'am.
There was some discussion of female recruits going through pugil stick training. What other changes to the program where female Marines are concerned will occur?
Again, the issue of the crucible and what we're doing with this whole mosaic we're trying to put together isn't a male-female issue. It's a Marine issue. We're preparing Marines. Some of those Marines just happen to be female. The changes and enhancements to female recruit training go all the way back to the mid to late 80s when we were the first of the armed forces to begin combat or begin giving combat training to our female Marines. We went through a process shortly after we came back from Desert Shield and Desert Storm of examining what we were doing with female recruit training. Were we living up to our moral obligation to prepare these young women for what they were going to encounter on the battlefield of the future? And in fact, about 3 years ago, made some significant enhancements to female recruit training. This latest is just an addition to that. The physical fitness test is going to be brought along lines or along the same lines as the male physical fitness test. They're going to be doing the pugil sticks. Jerry, is there any hitting skills they're going to be doing?
Does this indicate that the Marines are considering opening up more MOSs to women?
Absolutely not. We've got, you know, the guidance is out there. We're going to adhere to the guidance. But today's battlefield, the commandant said it. You know, in a three-block area, and in Somalia, you could literally, in a three-block area, go from humanitarian relief operations to peacekeeping operations to being in mid-intensity conflict. And we need to prepare our Marines for that. And there were female Marines over there, and they were doing those kinds of jobs. We have a moral obligation to those people and the people who they will lead on the battlefield to prepare them for what they're going to encounter. Yes, sir.
General, I was in Somalia, too, and there are many who say that it's not the job for the Marines or even the U.S. military, and they even say it in Haiti. And yet now, with what happened in Atlanta and what apparently has happened off Long Island, the White House and members of Congress are saying, let's get the military involved in anti-terrorism. I told General Krulak I was going to ask him the question, but he ducked out on me. But what is the role, as you see it, of the Marine Corps in anti-terrorism? And as part of your basic training and unit training, are you going to teach your young people certain skills dealing with anti-terrorism?
Sir, that's a question that's beyond the scope of this particular briefing. We're here to talk about the Crucible and the Mosaic we're putting together. We'd be more than happy, General Stanley, to get to side with you after the briefing and discuss that, if at all possible.
General, can I ask you one?
Well, let me move back here, if I may,
sir. Actually, getting to his earlier question about Okinawa, do you expect that your enhanced efforts to imbue people with Marine Corps values will alleviate the potentiality of that kind of problem happening in the future?
You know, I couldn't stand up here and tell you that we're going to eliminate all those kinds of things. Certainly, the hope is not only do we prepare, and the two goals and objectives of what we're trying to do here is to prepare those Marines for the battlefield of the future, but also to return them to society as better citizens. Inherent is in that is that they will be better Marines, more responsible Marines while they're on active duty as well. So, yes, we hope and certainly intend that this will have a positive impact on the moral nature of the Marines who are out there right now. Yes, sir.
Yes, and to that issue, and the issue of distractions, the distractions of this society. Tell us a little more about how you go about dealing with recruits that have, let's say, problems. Is this a matter really of deprogramming or what? And finally, about their faith, their spiritual the spiritual basis of their being good Marines.
Well, I could spend probably the better part of a day trying to answer those three questions, I believe. Let me start off by saying that that there are four kinds of people that we think apply for enlistment in the Marine Corps or for a commission in the Marine Corps, for that matter. The first kind are the ones, I think Commandant mentioned them when he first got up here, are those who come to us with good character values, good moral and family values already intact. And the Marine Corps, what the Marine Corps does for them is reinforce the value, if you will, of those values. There's another group of youngsters that come to my recruiters out there, my Marines who are assigned to recruiting duty, who have not been damaged by that society out there, but are in essence, don't have that strong structure. We look upon them as kind of empty vessels, and we attempt to fill those empty vessels up with our core values. The legacy of the Corps will be that we will return those youngsters to the society as better citizens. The third group that comes to us are those that have been damaged by society, that have been affected by those distractors, whether it's gang activity, whether it's hate groups, whether it's drugs, and the list is almost ad infinitum now. Our whole screening process is designed to look at that group of people and to apply the whole person concept to it and determine who within that group we are willing to take a risk on, to take a calculated risk on. Does this youngster have what it takes to complete the transformation and become a United States Marine? That may be the group that we have our greatest impact on. It may be the group that we live up to our legacy with if we can return that group to society as a better citizen. The last group are those that I call truly evil, the bad folks, the folks that we are trying to keep out of the Marine Corps, and our screening process is designed to identify them and deny them enlistment in the Marine Corps. Yes, ma'am.
General, I had a question. When is this going to be implemented, sir, and how is it going to be implemented?
Okay. Much of it is underway right now. We've already done the things on the recruiting side to enhance our screening process. We're in the process now of implementing a nationwide pool program. We've been for the last 3 or 4 years, if you will, screening the recruiters or the Marines who are assigned to the duty to ensure that they are, in fact, the best we have and proper role models. So in that regard, much of this is already ongoing. Jerry, you want to come up and talk about the recruit training portion?
Well, we began this study really about a year ago. And we have implemented some elements of this as we've gone along. But we officially start the Crucible. We hope to start with the group of young Marines or young recruits that come in October, that the December time frame would be the time that they go through the Crucible. And then that would follow on with the cohesion package that Colonel Newbold talked about.
I've got one back here, huh? Spread the wealth a little bit.
General, most of the media attention on Marine Corps training lately is focused on Quantico rather than on Paris Island or San Diego. Mm-hmm. Looking at anything along these lines for the officer candidates, or is this just an enlisted?
Absolutely. Issue? I remember if it was Keith or if it was the Commandant said, this is going to be applied across the spectrum of all of our schools out there. Aspects of this concept are going to be applied to the officer candidate course, to amphibious warfare school, to the basic school, to our command and staff colleges, to all of our NCO and staff NCO academies and that sort of thing. So you bet, this is a Marine Corps-wide program. Yes,
well,
sir.
To follow that, given the problem that you did have at Quantico and the fact that you've got a smaller group in officer candidate school, why aren't you beginning there with the leadership to make sure that things are in order?
Gosh, that's a good question. Greg, you want to come up and try to handle that one?
In fact, as you probably heard during the briefing, a number of the events that form the Crucible were taken out of Officer Candidate School, but they're taken as an individual entity. This represents a combination of different approaches, different pressures to mold and to build, and you'll see that taking place in Officer Candidate School after they're commissioned at the basic school and throughout, and we hope to apply the cohesion to them, too. It isn't a single event that's going to make a difference, but it's a combination of probably a dozen of them that we hope will.
How will you know if this program is a success? How do you measure its success?
It's a good question. How do we measure the success? There are a variety of ways. We've spoken about the attrition, the number of Marines that make it through their first term, the number of problems that we have among first-term Marines, among our career force. Also, we can judge by how Marines perform in crisis. That's not a measurable thing, but we will be judging probably on quantitative things that are measurable and by the drill instructors and what the commanders see from the Marines, and what you see when the Marines leave the service, when they rejoin the community.
And to back up what Greg just said, it's not that we're doing a bad job now. We think that we're doing a pretty darn good job, and that we turn out good Marines who are some of the finest the Corps has ever turned out. I saw a figure before I came over here that said the number of disciplinary cases in the Marine Corps has has been reduced by 60% between the years 1990 and 1995. We just think we need to do a better job as we go into the future. Part of the one of the ways to measure that is how many disciplinary cases we have in the future.
Maybe sir. I could close it out by asking this. Aside from improving the people you do get, are you having trouble getting people of intelligence and good moral character, given the fact that civilian employment is going up in the private sector? And number two, the fact that perhaps taking civilians out of the embassy in Monrovia isn't exactly washed in the glory of raising the flag on Iwo Jima. Why are you having trouble getting people who are ready, yea, anxious to fight?
No. And that's the short answer is no, absolutely not. I mentioned earlier that we are, tomorrow we will make mission, I'm sure, accomplish the goals that the Commandant has assigned to us for the 12th consecutive month. That mission includes not only the numbers of people that we need in order to keep the Marine Corps filled, but it includes the quality of the individuals as well. And we have exceeded every quality, target, goal, objective for both officer procurement and enlisted procurement that the Commandant has established for us. So no, we're still able to find the number of young men and women we need who want to be United States Marines.
Can we get the spellings of your name? I'm sorry, there were so many that came up.
Why don't we can do that perhaps afterwards, and if I'll handle one more question and we'll close it out here.
You talked about some of the changes for the women Marines in recruit training, but I understand that you're also going to expose them to the full Marine combat training after boot camp rather than give them the condensed version at Paris Island.
I'm sorry, would you repeat that again?
I understand you're going to, instead of having given the women Marines a condensed defensive combat training at Paris Island, you're going to shift that up and give them the equivalent to the Marine combat training at Lejeune that the male Marines get.
That's our intent, yes, sir, as we implement this program, that they will receive their MCT, their Marine combat training, just as their male counterparts do currently.
Expect the dropout rate to be higher according to this. Is there a DOR process during the crucible that would pare things down a bit?
No, absolutely not. In fact, we think if we do this right, the attrition both in the delayed entry program before they go to recruit training, in recruit training, and after recruit training will actually decrease. This is going to happen in their 10th or 11th week of training. I was Jerry's predecessor. I got to command the depot down at Paris Island for 2 years before he did. And by the 10th, 11th week, those youngsters will die before they'll leave recruit training. I mean, they're going to get through the crucible. They're going to graduate. They know that they're that far away from earning the Eagle, Globe, and Anchor, from becoming a United States Marine. So, no, sir, I think it's going to have just exactly the opposite effect.
Still ahead.
Beg pardon?
But if you're adding this last week, Crucible Week, Hell Week, they're in their 10th week. They know the hard stuff is still ahead of them.
They knew, but they know it's only 54 hours, and those drill instructors have them so pumped by that time that they'll do anything.
The purpose of it is to develop teamwork and to bind all that stuff together.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. We'll all stand by over here if you have need spellings of last names or whatever.
They have the bios on the table on the back, and the spelling and everything right there.
Okay.